Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Tayyaba Science Center. So today I am back again with a new topic, which is NMR spectroscopy. So let's begin. In NMR spectroscopy, NMR stands for nucleus magnetic resonance. What does it mean is, it is basically based on the magnetic properties of nuclei that results from nuclear spin. So nucleus has positive charge and it spins around its own axis and it has angular momentum. So it behaves as a tiny magnet and it has magnetic properties. So there are two I plus one spin states for a nucleus where I is nuclear spin quantum number. What does it mean is that magnetic properties of nucleus basically arise from proton and neutrons present into it. The proton and neutron has spin number 1 by 2 and when they are not paired, so there will be some resulting nuclear spin, so which is known as I, and we can calculate the number of spin states by this formula 2i plus 1. So there are some rules. If number of sum of neutron plus proton is odd, I will be half integer. In this case, this number of proton plus neutron is 1, so it will be 1 by 2. In this case, it is 3 by 2. Second rule is, if number of proton plus neutron is even, I is integer. In this case, you can see number of proton 7 plus neutron 7. So the resultant will be 14, which is an even number. So I will be 1 in this case. And if number of neutron and number of proton are even number, I will be 0. That is, they'll be having no spin states and there'll be no NMR signal. In this case, the number of proton is 2 and the number of neutron is also 2. So they both are even number. So I will be 0. So to calculate the spin states, we can use this formula. There is one example for hydrogen. I is 1 by 2. So we can calculate its spin state by this formula. We put this value of 1 by 2 here. So we get 2, which basically means that there are two spin states, plus half and minus half. What does it mean is that this is the direction of applied magnetic field. And when we place this nuclei in this applied magnetic field, if it aligns itself in the direction of the applied magnetic field, and there is one more chance that it can align itself opposite to the direction of applied magnetic field. So if it aligns itself to the direction of applied magnetic field, it will be more stable and it will be having less energy. And if it aligns itself opposite to the direction of applied magnetic field, it will be less stable and it will be having more energy. So here it will be more stable, here it is less stable. And the energy in this case is more than here. So energy required for the flip of electron from energy 1 to energy 2 depends upon the energy difference between two states. So what does it mean is that if we want to flip this nuclei from here to here, it basically depends upon the energy difference between two states, and it can calculate it by this formula. H gamma H0 upon 2 pi, where gamma is gyromagnetic ratio, H0 is applied magnetic field. It is basically a constant. So in this formula, you can see that the energy difference is directly proportional to the applied magnetic field. So if applied magnetic field will be zero, the energy difference will also be zero. That is, in absence of magnetic field, two spin states have equal energy. Like, there is magnetic field applied, but if it is not applied, they both will be having equal energy and there will be no energy difference. Next. Nuclear shielding and deshielding. So we can take this example and we can understand these terms. So first take example of CH3, which is this case. So in every case there is a positive nucleus and around which there is electron cloud. So there is electron cloud which is present here is very dense and it produced a magnetic field which is called an induced magnetic field, which basically shield this nucleus, and it also opposes this applied magnetic field. So this nuclei will get shielded, And to bring this nuclei to resonance, we need to apply more field. So basically, they will absorb up field. And in the second case, we take this example CH2. So there is less electron cloud, and why is it? Because there is present the electronegative group, which will decrease electron cloud on the CH2, because of which this electron cloud produce, or basically what does it do is it, this nucleus basically get deshielded because of the less electron cloud around itself, so it will absorb downfield. So electronegative groups cause deshielding, and hydrogen bonding also cause deshielding. Next, what are equivalent and non-equivalent protons? So equivalent protons are those who are having same environment and absorb at same magnetic field. Non-equivalent protons are those having different environment and absorb at different magnetic field. So again, we can take this example. So there is CH3. So we can expand it by like this. CH, H, and H. So all these three protons are attached to the carbon, so basically they are having same environment around themselves, so they all three are equivalent hydrogen. Similar cases here, they both hydrogen are attached to carbon, and both are having CH3 groups on their left side and Cl group on their right side, so they both are equivalent. So how can we check it? What we need to do is just replace a hydrogen with another group. So if you get same product in every case, so they are equivalent hydrogen, like I did here. I replaced one hydrogen here with Z and another hydrogen here with Z, but both these products are same, so they both protons are equivalent. Similar thing I did here, I replaced one hydrogen with Z and then another with Z, but these both products are similar, so these protons are equivalent. But if we compare these two products, they both are different products. That means the protons which are present here and the proton which are present here are different from each other, so these protons are non-equivalent. So basically we get a single peak for equivalent hydrogen. Like equivalent protons do not give different peaks. So if we calculate NMR peaks here, so this is CH2, but these both hydrogen are similar, so we get only one peak for CH2. And in case of CH3, we will not get single peak here because these two protons are different from each other, they are non-equivalent. So non-equivalent protons gives different peaks, so we get different peak for it, but only single peak for CH3 because all these three hydrogens are similar. So you must be thinking that we should have gotten five peaks, but we get only two peaks because these protons are equivalent, and these two are non-equivalent, so we get different peak for both of them. So this is all about equivalent and non-equivalent protons. Next, what is chemical shift? The shift in the position of signal resulting through shielding and deshielding by circulation of electron is called chemical shift. So I explained you shielding and deshielding before. How does it occur? So because of shielding and deshielding, the shift in the position of signal occur, which is known as chemical shift. So the reference we take to calculate this chemical shift is tetramethylsilane. This it will be methyl, or also known as TMS. So what is TMS? Is this is a structure of TMS, and why it has been chosen a reference? Because it is highly shielded, it has a single sharp peak, it has low boiling point, it is soluble in most of the organic solvent. So this chemical shift can also be defined as, it can also define as the separation in the position of signals of proton due to different environment relative to TMS. So what does it means is that we had different proton, like if we have non-equivalent proton, so they'll give different peaks. So the separation in their position with respect to TMS is known as chemical shift. So its unit is hertz or CPS or cycle per second or PPM, parts per million. So the chemical shift can be calculated by this formula: H sample minus H reference upon H reference into 10^6. So this frequency of sample minus frequency of reference, which is our TMS, tetramethylsilane, and this is also frequency of reference. So basically chemical shift expressed in two scale, one is delta scale, another is tau scale, and this delta and tau are related to each other by this formula. So we take TMS as zero, and we calculate the value of chemical shifts of other compound with reference to this TMS. So we can, if we are getting these two peaks, what does it mean is that the protons which are giving low value of delta are basically shielded, and the protons which are giving high value of delta are deshielded protons, because we get a low value of delta for shielded protons and high value of delta for deshielded protons. So these are the values of chemical shift. So you can learn them, it will help you in solving the questions. So take a screenshot and learn all the values. Next, splitting of NMR signals or N plus 1 rule. So this is a compound, so we should have got two peaks for this compound, because these two hydrogen are equivalent, so we'll get one peak for this, and this hydrogen is different from this, so these two are non-equivalent, so we'll get one more peak for this. So we should have got two peaks for this compound, but we get five peaks. So how? So consider this example. Suppose this is our example. So how does these splitting occur is basically due to the adjacent protons. So if we want to study about the splitting of secondary proton, we need to look at the tertiary proton. So suppose in the absence of tertiary proton, we were getting single peak this signal, but when due to the presence of this tertiary proton, it will produce some magnetic field, and if it is aligned to the direction of the applied magnetic field, it will increase the strength of the magnetic field of secondary proton, and they will absorb downfield. And if the magnetic field produced by this tertiary proton aligned opposite to the direction of applied magnetic field, the strength of the magnetic field for a secondary proton will get reduced, and they'll absorb upfield. So there are basically two probabilities, so due to which this peak will get split into two. So this is the case for secondary protons. By the similar way, we can calculate splitting here. So before studying them, there is one rule we need to study. The number of peaks into which a given proton signal is split is equal to N plus 1, where N is equals to number of hydrogen on adjacent carbon. So this is example. If you want to calculate the number of peaks in for CH3, so you can calculate by this formula N plus 1, but the number of hydrogen you're going to put should be on adjacent carbon atom. So we will put 2 here, because if you are calculating the number of peaks for CH3, we need to look on the protons present on the adjacent carbon atom. So the number of protons present on the adjacent carbon atom is 2, so it will be 2 plus 1 3. So we will get triplet for the CH3. In the similar way, if you want to calculate the number of peaks for CH2, you need to look for the proton on adjacent carbon atom. So the number of proton on the CH3 is 3, so we'll put 3 here, 3 plus 1 4, so we'll get quartet for this CH2. And the splitting of signals does not take place in case of equivalent proton. So now we can study this. Suppose if we are calculating the number of peaks for CH, we need to look for the number of protons on adjacent carbon atoms. So the number of protons on the secondary carbon is 2. So how many peaks we'll get? 2 plus 1, 3. So basically we are getting 3 splittings here. In a similar way, if you want to calculate the number of peaks for this tertiary structure, and we are having this primary group attached to it, so the number of hydrogen on it is 3, so the number of peaks will be n plus 1, and the n is 3, so it will be 3 plus 1, 4, so the splitting here are 4. By this way, you can calculate the number of peaks or splitting on any structure. Next, what is coupling constant? The distance between the centers of two adjacent peaks in a multiplet is called coupling constant. So this is peak, these are peaks, so the distance between the center of two adjacent peak is known as coupling constant. So this is the center of this peak and this is the center of this peak, so the distance between them is known as coupling constant. It is denoted by G and it remains constant in different applied magnetic field. So this coupling constant is different from chemical shift, because chemical shift change on changing magnetic field, but this coupling constant does not change on changing applied magnetic field. So this is a method of distinguishing between compounds, because if the separation between the peaks changes on changing applied field, then they represent different signal, and if the separation between the adjacent peak do not change, then they represent the peak of the multiplet. What does it mean? That if you are changing applied field and if the separation between the signal changes, because suppose this signal we are getting here and this signal we are getting here, and if we change magnetic field, suppose we get the signal away from here and the signal away from here, so basically the distance between the two peaks are changing, signals are changing, not peaks. So it is due to the chemical shift, or the compound can be different or structure different, but if we are but these distance between these peaks will not change. So what we are getting is that these peaks are due to the multiplet and not of signals. So the factors which affects this coupling constant is geminal coupling. What is this geminal coupling? Is that the proton which are present on the same carbon but are non-equivalent are known as geminal proton, and when they are non-equivalent, they show spin-spin splitting, which is known as geminal coupling. So I hope you have understood that these both protons are different, because this proton is having Br on one of its side and this proton is having chlorine on one of its side, and both are attached to the same carbon, so they are geminal proton and are showing geminal coupling. There is one more coupling which is known as vicinal coupling, and it is because of the proton attached on different carbon atom but are non-equivalent. Next, application of NMR spectroscopy. So it helps in structural identity of compound. So by this NMR spectroscopy, you can check structural identity, because if two compounds are giving same NMR spectra, then they both should be identical. Then identification of reaction product. Suppose we get sometime two products in reaction. So if we are getting two different peaks, it means that the reaction is forming two different products. And then distinction between geometrical isomer. So this is cis and this is trans. So the value of coupling constant for J for cis is 6 to 12 hertz and for trans is 12 to 18 hertz. So by this method we can differentiate between cis and trans. So this is the method for interpretation of NMR spectra, that how can you interpret this spectra. So by this formula you can calculate degree of unsaturation, which is 2C plus 2 plus N minus X minus H upon 2, where C is number of carbon in a molecular formula, N is number of hydrogen, X is halogen and H is hydrogen. So if the value of degree of unsaturation or U is coming 1, then the compound may contain either one double bond or one ring. And if the value of U is 2, then these three are the possibilities. Either it will be having one triple bond or two double bond or one double bond and one ring. Any one of them can be case. Next, if you're getting the value of delta between 3 to 4, it means that proton on a carbon bearing an electronegative element. So this proton if the value of this proton is coming between 3 to 4, it means that this proton is having electronegative group. This proton is attached to the carbon, and to the carbon where this proton is attached must be containing an electronegative group. If the value of delta is coming between 2.1 to 2.6, it means that proton is adjacent to the carbonyl group. There should be a carbonyl group, and the carbon adjacent to it containing proton will give this value. Next is, if the value of delta is 2.3 to 2.9, it means that proton and benzylic carbon. So this is benzylic carbons, as here it is carbonyl carbon and the proton it is containing will give this value. Similarly, this carbon is benzylic carbon and the proton attaches to it will give this value. If you are getting a singlet around this, it means that there presents a terminal alkyne. That means this group. If you are getting the value of delta between 5 to 6, it means vinylic proton are present. And value of J can be used to differentiate between cis and trans. So this is cis. The value of J for it is 10 CPS and for it 15 CPS. If you're getting the value of delta between 7 to 8, it means aromatic protons. Suppose the proton present on benzenes will give this value. And if you're getting the value of delta between 9 to 10, it means aldehydic proton. Means proton is directly attached to the carbonyl group and not like this case where it is attached to the carbonyl group. Carbonyl carbon. So if proton is attached to the carbonyl carbon, you will get this value. And if it is directly attached to the carbonyl group, you will get the value between 9 to 10. So these are few examples to calculate NMR signals. So I'll suggest all of you to pause the video, write down all the questions and do solve and then match with my answers. So I'm explaining all of them. So three protons are present here and three protons are present here. They both are having same environment around themselves because all the three protons are having oxygen on one of its side, and these three protons are also having oxygen, and they all three are attached to the carbon. Here all three are attached to the carbon. So all six protons are same, so we'll get one signal for it. In the next case, similar cases here, all these three protons are attached to the same carbon. Here all these attached to the same carbon and both are near to this C double bond O group at the same distance, both protons, all protons actually, so they all be similar, so we'll get one signal for it. Then this example, all proton are identical, all are equivalent, so we'll get one signal for it. Then this example, CH3CH2Br. So these three protons are equivalent, same, but they are different from these protons, as their proton are having bromine on one of its side, but they are not having. So we'll get two signal for this compound. Here we are having this oxygen group attached here. So this CH3 group is nearest to this oxygen, so we'll get one signal for it. So now this CH2 is also near to this oxygen, but it is also attached to this CH3, so it is different from this CH3, so it will give one signal. Now this CH3 is away from this oxygen as compared to this, so it will give one signal. So basically we get three signals for this compound. Now next, similarly, this CH2 group is near to the C double bond O group, so it will give one signal. But this CH3 group is away from the C double bond O, so it will give one more signal. And the hydrogen which is attached to hydroxyl group also gives signals. So we will get three signals for this compound. Now come to this group. Now consider that this structure is in plane and the group you are showing here are above the plane and these groups are below the plane. So consider the first example of this group. So above the plane it is having Br group on one side and Br group on other side, and below the plane it is having H. Now consider this group. This is so it will give one signal. Now this is hydrogen. It is having hydrogen group below the plane. This hydrogen is below the plane, and these are also below the plane. So it is surrounded by two hydrogen atoms below the plane, and it is having one hydrogen above the plane attached to it, so it is basically different from it. So they both give different signals. Now consider this example, it is having two hydrogen below the plane and having a bromine attached to it on above the plane. Similar with this, it has two hydrogen below the plane and this bromine attached above the plane. So basically we'll get three signals for this compound. Now consider this example. Consider this H. It has this bromine and H above the plane and then having this hydrogen below the plane. Similar for this, this hydrogen is having this hydrogen and bromine below the plane and hydrogen above the plane. So they both are similar, so we get one signal for it. Now consider this example. It is having hydrogen and bromine above the plane, as it is above the plane, and it is having bromine down the plane. Now consider this example, it is also having bromine and H below the plane and bromine attached to it above the plane, so they both are also similar, so we'll get two signal for it. Next, so these are few examples, so you guys just pause the video here or take a screenshot and do solve them and then match your answer with mine. So these are all our answer of these questions. So as you can see, these all CH3 group are attached to the same carbon atom, so they all will give a signal, single signal. And then this CH3 group, as you can see, is attached to this O group and it is completely different from them, so it will give one signal, so we will get two signal for this compound. Now here they both are identical and they are attached to the same group, so we'll get one signal for it. Now here this CH2 is attached to this group and this CH is away from this group and it is basically attached with two chlorine groups, so you can clearly see that these protons are completely different from each other, so you'll get two signal for it. Now consider this example, so this was my compound and I expanded it and I wrote it like this. This carbon is having two hydrogen, then this carbon is attached to H and then this group, so I wrote it here. So I'll get five signal for it. And how? This carbon is attached to hydrogen, so it is having hydrogen one of its side and this group on its other side, so its signal will be different. Now consider this hydrogen, it is having hydrogen on this side and this hydrogen on this side, so it is also different because this hydrogen is having hydrogen on one of its side and then this group on it other side, so it will be also different. Then the CH2 is nearer to the C group but is different from all of them, so it will give one signal. Then this hydroxyl group, the proton attached to hydroxyl group give one signal, so we'll total get five signal for this compound. Now consider this structure, I have opened this structure and have written it like this. So this carbon is having two hydrogen, then this carbon is having hydrogen and chlorine, so this carbon is having chlorine on one of its sides, so it will give one signal. Now consider this hydrogen, it is having hydrogen in one side and then this hydrogen here, so it will give one signal because this hydrogen is having hydrogen here and chlorine here, so all these three hydrogen will give different signals because they are non-equivalent, so we will get three signal for it. Now consider this example, this CH2 group is having chlorine on one of its side, then this CH2 group. Now consider this, it is also having chlorine on one of its side, then the CH2 group. So they both are equivalent, so we will get one signal for them. But this CH2 group is different from them because they are having chlorine attached to them to the same carbon, but here no chlorine. So we'll get two signal for it. Now consider this example. If you write this structure in open form, you'll understand it better. This proton, these protons are nearer to the CO group, they'll give one signal. Then the CH3 is away from them, so it'll give one signal. Then this is CH group, which is different from, because it has two CH3 group attaches to it, which is different from them. So this proton will give one signal. Then these two protons are, or six all total protons are equivalent, so it'll give one signal. So all total we will get four signal. Now consider this example. This CH3 group is attached to COO, then this CH2 group is attached to COO and one of its side it is having CH2. So this CH3 will give one signal and the CH2 will give one signal, but they both are equivalent if you can see. So these CH2, both CH2 will give one signal, and these both CH2 will give one signal. So all total we will get two signal. Now consider this example. These examples are like them. This hydrogen is having CH3 on one of its sides and H on one side, so it will give one signal. Now this hydrogen is having hydrogen on one side and chlorine on other side, so it will give one signal. Now all these three hydrogen are attached to the same carbon atom, so they all give one signal, but they are different from them. So we will get three signals. Now consider here. These both CH3 group are same, because if you can see, it has H on one side and CH3 on one side. In the similar way, the CH3 has CH3 on one side and H on one side. So they both are similar, so we'll get one signal for them. In the similar way, they both are similar, so we'll get one signal for them. So all total, we'll get two signals. Now consider this example. I have written this structure in open form. So this is the structure. So they both CH3 are attached to the same carbon atom, so we'll get one signal for it, but this H is different from them as it has chlorine attached near to it, so it will give one signal. So all total we will get two signals. Now consider this example. This CH group is attached here like this, so it will give one signal. This group is away from it, so it will give one signal. And this CH3 group is directly attached to oxygen, so we'll get one signal for it. So all total we'll get three signals. Next, from following data predict the compound. So again I would say that pause the video, so try to solve all these questions and then match with mine. So these two questions and then these two questions, so take screenshot of them or pause the video and try to solve them. So this is the molecular formula of a compound is C6H14O. We are getting this multiplet at 3.56, which is for 2 hydrogen. Then we are getting this doublet at 1.0 for 12 hydrogen, so we need to predict the structure. So the first thing by which we can predict structure is that if there'll be present, so there are 6 protons, so you must be thinking that there could be a ring also, but no, there cannot be a ring, because if there would be a ring, there would be having aromatic protons, and the value for aromatic protons comes near 7 point something, and so we are not having any value like that. So by this we can conclude that there would be no ring, or you can calculate it by unsaturation formula I told you before, but this is a shortcut to predict that. So basically what you need to do is that you can get an idea that 12 hydrogen are similar, and for all of them we are getting a doublet. And what does this doublet mean? This is basically splitting. So splitting we calculate from adjacent carbon, so it means that to the carbon where these 12 hydrogen attach, and to near that carbon there should be no, sorry, there should be no hydrogen, or sorry, one hydrogen, then only we can get a doublet. Because when we'll get a doublet, what I'm trying to say is that suppose these 12 hydrogen, although 12 hydrogen cannot get attached to the same carbon, but just consider that all these 12 hydrogen are attached here, and we are getting a doublet. So what does it mean that how we calculate this doublet, triplet, by the number of proton present on the adjacent carbon atom is n plus 1, sorry, n plus 1, where n is number of protons present on adjacent carbon atom. So when you can get doublet, when the number of n will be 1 or the number of proton will be 1, then only you can get a doublet. So what we can predict from it, that the number of hydrogen present on the adjacent carbon atom where these 12 hydrogen are present will be having 1 hydrogen. Now you can predict one thing, that carbon can attach only 3 hydrogen, so we will attach 3 hydrogen here. It is these 12. Now the second thing you can predict is that there are 12 hydrogen which are similar. So how can they be similar if they are attached to the same carbon atom? So I'll attach one more, and you need to attach 12 hydrogen which should be similar. So we cannot attach more 6 hydrogen here, because the three valencies of carbon has been completed, so we can only attach CH3 here. So this we cannot fulfill this condition. So what we need is we need one more CH. So we take one more CH and we attach two CH3 group here. So by this we can attach 12 hydrogen. So now we have attached 12 hydrogen, and this two hydrogen we were getting multiplied. So this, for this hydrogen and this hydrogen, you will get multiplied because there are number of hydrogen attached to it. Now the, if you calculate the number of carbon are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the number of hydrogen is also 14. So what you need is one more oxygen, so you just simply add them with oxygen. So by this way you can predict the structure of a compound. Next question. So the molecular formula of compound is C10H14. We are getting singlet at 0.88 for 9 hydrogen, and we are getting singlet for 7.285 hydrogen. So here I'm going to tell you a shortcut which can apply maximum time, not always, but maximum time. If you're getting singlet and delta is having value near 7 something, and for 5 hydrogen, or sometimes you can have 3 hydrogen because if CH3 is attached to the benzene ring. So basically what does this suggest is that this is basically for benzene. So if you see it anywhere, just try to solve it by making a benzene ring. So just make a benzene ring, and these 5 hydrogen are these hydrogen attached to it. Now your 6 carbon has been utilized. Now you need 4 more carbon, and what you're seeing here that these 9 hydrogens should be similar. So the thought which can come to your mind is that you attach a carbon here. If you try to make a change, you can only attach 2 hydrogen, 2, 2, 2, 2. So by this you cannot attach 9 hydrogen and you will not get singlet. When you get singlet is that to the carbon where these 9 hydrogen are attached, and to the adjacent carbon to that you should be having no hydrogen, then only you can get singlet, because the formula is n plus 1, so the number of n should be 0, then only you can get value 1, that is singlet. So by this we have predicted that this carbon will be having no hydrogen, and now we need to complete the valency of this carbon, so we will simply make 4 bond. Now what we can do is we simply attach CH3 everywhere. So by this tricks you can predict the structure of the compound. So this of course double bonds also. So this is the structure of the compound. Next. So the molecular formula is C9H11Br, and the tau. So basically you need to convert it to delta, which I have converted here. So these are the values of the delta. So again, if you can see here, there is a singlet which delta is having 7.22 value, and again 5 hydrogen. So when you see it anywhere in the question, just make a benzene ring. Not always it, you know, possible, but most of the times. So this is a benzene ring. Then you are getting triplet for 2 hydrogen, then triplet for 2 hydrogen, then multiplet for 2 hydrogen. So whenever any carbon is attached to the benzene ring, so this position will be having no hydrogen, but there are many hydrogens, so you will get multiplet for the carbon which is directly attached to the benzene ring. So this is carbon, and then it will be having 2 hydrogen, then you are getting triplet for 2 hydrogen and 2 hydrogen. So this can give triplet because there is for this carbon it can give triplet because it is having 2 hydrogen, and when you add 1 to it, it will become 3 and it will give triplet. So for these 2 hydrogen you will be having triplet. Next, you are having 2 more hydrogen which are giving triplet, so by here you will have triplet, so it is CH2. So now your all C9H11 has been utilized and you are left with Br, so you will just simply add on Br here. And by this you can predict structure. Next compound, your molecular formula is C9H12. Singlet you are getting at 6.88, and this value is 2.25. So here you are having singlet, you are having this value near to this benzene ring, but here is for 3 hydrogen. So if you see that case, make benzene ring, because most of the time it is benzene ring if it is more than 6. And for benzene you can also use this formula CnH2n-6. So here you are having n as 9, so C9H 9 is to 2, 18 minus 6 will be 12. So this is the formula of a benzene. So by this you can also predict that there could be a benzene ring. So this is a benzene ring. Now we are having singlet for 9 hydrogens. So we cannot add any carbon here, because if you will add a carbon, you should be getting multiplet, and all 9 hydrogen cannot be similar. So what we can do is we can attach 3 CH3 group, and as you know that these group attach at para position with respect to each other. So by this I have attached these 3 CH3 groups. So by this you can predict structure. So this was all about today, and I'll make a new video on more examples. So to get notification for my more upcoming videos, hit the bell icon, and if you like my video, do subscribe and share with your friends who need this. And yeah, thanks.